breaking news coming out of the House of Representatives, where a resolution has just passed condemning anti-Semitism and other forms of bigotry. The House Speaker Nancy Pelosi had struggled to contain the fallout from comments made by the freshman lawmaker, Democrat Ilhan Omar. Our congressional correspondent, Sunlen Sarfati, has been tracking the controversy. So give us the very latest, Sunlen.
Well, Wolf, this resolution just passed in the floor of the House of Representatives by a vote of 407-23, one person voting present. Notably here, no Democrats voted against this resolution, including Ilhan Omar. She voted for this resolution. She, the person that really sparked this controversy and sparked this resolution from needing to be written in the first place. 23 Republicans voted against this. Many Republicans we heard going into this vote took to the floor during the time of debate and said that they felt that this resolution was too broad. The way it was rewritten, and certainly it had been rewritten many ways over the last few days, they felt it covered too much ground, that they would have, they say, have it preferred to have it focused just on opposing anti-Semitism. This resolution really did merge to not necessarily focus on anti-Semitism specifically, but far broader, anti-hate in general, calling out anti-Semitism, anti-Islamophobia, and anti-white supremacy. And that's certainly a product at the end of the day that Nancy Pelosi felt the pressure to do, felt the pressure after there was so much consternation, so much concern, a bitter battle over the last 48 hours within her Democratic caucus. Those who felt like this anti-Semitic resolution as it stood 2 days ago singled out Ilhan Omar too much, and they pushed Nancy Pelosi to make these changes, and the changes in the end meant that this did pass on the floor of the U.S. House of Representatives. But certainly House Democratic leadership, Wolf, will have to recover from the battle that really highlighted the very deep divides within their caucus right now.
Well, what does that say, Sunlen, about the deep divides between the establishment Democratic leadership, Nancy Pelosi, and the other top leaders in the House of Representatives versus some of the newcomers who are just arriving in Washington?
It shows, Wolf, that they potentially will have to stumble and will hit these problems going forward, too. This wasn't necessarily just only about allegations of anti-Semitism. It was about the power that this new wing of the Democratic Party, especially over in the House, has. The fact that we heard from many House freshmen speaking up and coming to the defense of their friend and colleague Ilhan Omar, and that was able to push the so-called old guard up here on Capitol Hill. So it will be such a fascinating dynamic to watch as the days and weeks and months go on with this new freshman class.
Well, the resolution, and it's a lengthy resolution, it's got a lot of details in there. We've all gone through it, overwhelmingly passed in the House of Representatives. Let me get Chris Salisa's reaction.
Yeah, first of all, I think Sunlen hit it right. What this is, putting aside the mishigas of the back and forth of this past week, what this speaks to is the changing contours of the Democratic Party, both in Congress and more broadly nationally. This is a fight that will happen on the presidential level as well. What you saw was what seemed to Nancy Pelosi and the other Democratic leaders to be relatively straightforward. Ilhan Omar, who has made comments in the past at AIPAC, the Israeli group, that they seem to think was anti-Semitic. Elliot Engel,
the pro-Israel.
Pro-Israel. Yeah. Elliot Engel, a prominent Jewish member of Congress, head of the Foreign Relations Committee, comes out and says she should apologize. Okay, so Nancy Pelosi thinks, okay, well, we're operating on the way things usually work. Let's draft a resolution. Let's say we condemn this. Except she didn't calculate for the fact that the party is changing. These younger members, we talk a lot about Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, but there's many others. They don't play by those same rules of the sit back, do what the leadership tells you, don't really speak your mind, kind of wait and see. You don't want to get in trouble because then you won't move up the seniority ladder. So this conflict is born of a rare miscalculation by Nancy Pelosi, who I think is, you know, one of the most gifted politicians of her generation, at least, of what this Democratic Party is willing to say and do and fight for. This is, Sunlen made it right. This is not an isolated incident. This may be forgotten. There will be other things like this in the future. And to be honest, they wasted a week that they were hoping to talk about the fact that the Senate is going to pass a resolution that says they disapprove of Donald Trump's border wall, the Republican-controlled Senate, and what they're going to do tomorrow, which is pass the House, which is pass an ethics package and a campaign finance reform package. We haven't talked anything about that. We spent the whole week on this thing.
Yeah, a lot of the Democratic leaders were complaining about the media. Some of them even sounding like Donald Trump complaining about the media in this particular case. Bianna, what do you think?
Look, I agree. I think this was some attention that the Democratic Party did not see coming and did not necessarily seek as well. There had been a lot of whataboutisms. Look at what the president has said. Look at what other Republican members of Congress have said in the past, sort of to deflect off of what the issue at hand was. But the White House and I think a lot of Republicans were able to use this opportunity to highlight the increasing divide that you do see amongst Congress and the sort of older generation of Democratic congressmen and the new freshman congressmen. I think for Nancy Pelosi and leadership, their goal now is to make this a one-off and move forward. It's TBD to see if this conversation continues and if other comments are made similar to those that sparked this entire debate.
It's an important, Phil, I want to get your reaction too.
But didn't we see this in the last election where an older insurgent, that is yep. Bernie Sanders, says, let me pull the party out. It hurts the party because it divides them against the worst candidate in history. Now we have new insurgents saying, hey, we're going into an election where we need to be unified, maybe around a moderate candidate, Joe Biden, but let's see if we can separate the party again. This isn't the first time this happened. We just saw people go after Joe Biden for saying Mike Pence is a decent guy. And insurgents, including from New York, say, you can't say the vice president's a decent guy. If they don't figure out that is the Democrats how to solve this, I'm looking at the last election, 2016, and saying, I think we just did this.
Yeah. But part of the challenge that Pelosi has is not just addressing a legitimate disagreement, good faith disagreement within her own party, itself a really, really monumental task. She also has to figure out how to address those concerns while not allowing the other side to exploit and exacerbate yeah. those, both in good and bad faith. And so I think this is one of the things that we're seeing, sort of the original, this very rare misstep on Pelosi's part, is that she still thinks that she's dealing with her party. She hasn't yet figured out how exactly to address some of this criticism that's coming from the other side that's not so much about substance and more about sort of twisting the knife.
And which, by the way, the reason for the timing of this, the reason that it was, number one, they said they were going to do something, so they had to do something. I mean, that resolution as written, Wolf, really covers, it essentially says, do you like good things and not like bad things? I mean, effectively. Mm-hmm. And number two, to Susan's point, there was an effort by Republicans to say, hey, Wolf, We got a resolution we could introduce to try to further divide the Democratic Party up and say, well, like take advantage of that little hole that they have been given. So again, the majority is something every politician wants, but can be a very much a double-edged sword in that to win it, you need a broad party with lots of victories across the ideological spectrum. The problem is, if you get those victories, you have a lot of members across a very broad ideological spectrum.
Yeah, and look, go ahead, Bianca.
I was going to say, Speaker Pelosi tried her best at presenting a united front today and hoping to put this issue to rest. But as we know, maybe it's one of the reasons that Democrats were frustrated with media this week as well, because you continue to hear what was happening behind closed doors and things got very heated. One anecdote that stood out to me was one Congress member said, you know, everybody stay off of Twitter. That is sort of the best way to avoid situations like this going forward. So, you know, the big question is, will this continue?
And this resolution not only condemned anti-Semitism, it condemned anti-Muslim discrimination, all forms of bigotry. I'll read the first sentence just to give you a sense, but it's a very long resolution. Condemning anti-Semitism as hateful expressions of intolerance that are contradictory to the values and aspirations that define the people of the United States, and condemning anti-Muslim discrimination and bigotry against minorities as hateful expressions of intolerance that are contrary to the value and aspirations of the United States. And then it goes on to explain. That's why more than 400 of the 435 members of the House voted in favor of this resolution.